Well, hi there, and welcome once again to In Search of Christianity, brought to you by Bible Talk. And once again, on behalf of Alice and Mark, myself and Bible Talk, we want to just greet you in the wonderful, the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
And we're blessed that you can join us once again for time in God's wonderful Word, which is holy and pure,
yes,
and has the ability to change us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, yeah, we're studying, we're continuing on. We've been studying for the last few weeks now, quite a few weeks, actually, the fruit of the Holy Spirit as the evidence of a redeemed life, okay? Because I've said this before, if we're going to search for Christianity, the best place to start searching is in the mirror. We need to examine ourselves and see that we are walking in the ways that the Lord desires.
Amen.
Amen. Before we start, let me just remind you that we really want to encourage you to write to us at BibleTalk.com or visit us on Facebook, either Bible Talk or In Search of Christianity.
Write to us at office at BibleTalk.com.
Write to us at office at BibleTalk.com. So you can, if you have any questions or comments, we'd love to have a dialogue, you know, be able to.
Sure.
I am blessed and I praise God for the technology that we have. But it doesn't, it's not as good as face-to-face.
No, never is.
So if you see me on the street, stop me and let's talk, let's chat. Hug me, run up and hug me. Hallelujah.
Have some church.
Yeah. Okay. So anyhow, we've been talking about the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And last week we started talking about goodness, which is a fruit of the Spirit. And that's what we're going to pick up today. We're in the middle of that. But before we do that, I'm going to ask Brother Mark if you'll pray and ask God's blessing on our time together.
Thank you. Oh, Lord, we just thank you because you are good.
Amen.
You are faithful and trustworthy, Lord. And we just thank you for sending your Son for salvation's sake. And just bless this Bible study. And just I pray that it goes out and it meets the needs of whoever sees it. Amen.
Amen. Well, hallelujah. Well, as I said, we're looking at goodness, all right? Last week, we talked about goodness in relationship to a relationship between, we have a relationship with God.
Yes.
That's about righteousness.
Right.
Right? Our relationship with each other, that's actually about morality. Our behavior, one with another, is about moral behavior. Now, God desires that our behavior be righteous. But, you know, it is about morality because, I'm just saying to Mark, years ago, the Supreme Court of the United States had heard a case, and I mentioned this in the last study if you want to go back and look at it, about obscenity. And the Supreme Court of the United States determined, they ruled, that what determines obscenity, what makes something obscene, is the community standards, local community standards. So when they say local, that means that the standards here, where we are in the Orlando, Florida area, could be very, very different than the standards in San Francisco, California.
Most definitely.
And because the people as a group determine what's moral and what's not. So you have community standards to determine that, and or just as an individual, you can determine what your behavior, what you believe right behavior is, or the Lord God Almighty determines what's right behavior between men, right?
That's the bottom line.
So we were talking about community behavior, and as I said, that's where we're going to pick up. We were just about to finish up on the community, seeing the community as, or in other words, a group of people determining what they consider to be right or wrong behavior. And a thought struck me as I was praying that years ago, back in the 1980s, as a matter of fact, the three of us, we were all involved. I was a pastor of a church here in Florida. I guess it was in the mid-1980s. There was a major move that was actually, I mean, it was covered by news around all over the United States. And it had to do with a chain of stores called 7-Elevens,
yes,
which are convenience stores. So for my friends in England, that's kind of like a little shop, country, you know, a corner shop that has milk and whatever
groceries,
products and
small
dry goods. And But it's a major corporation. I mean, it's a gigantic corporation all around the United States of America. And in their stores, they carried magazines, what they call men's magazines or adult magazines, such as Playboy magazine, Penthouse magazine, those. And the church, or a church group, I think led by the Baptist denomination, put pressure on them and had a move where they were boycotting 7-Eleven and picketing 7-Eleven to remove those magazines.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Huh? It's profane.
Because they're profane. Okay, Al says it's because they were profane. Now, without doubt, I don't ever get the idea that I'm sitting here and I'm going to defend those magazines. So after quite a period of time where there was, I mean, really an uproar, where they were picketing the stores, where they were boycotting the 7-Eleven stores, 7-Eleven removed those particular magazines and stopped selling them entirely. So the church was celebrating that part of the church that had done this, celebrated, greatly celebrated, their victory over 7-Eleven. I can't say that I have any objection to them removing those magazines. But at the end of the day, I walked into 7-Eleven after that, and that store was still filled with obscenity. Okay? The obscenity may have taken place with the magazines that were these gossip magazines. Mm-hmm. Do you not think that gossip is obscene to God?
Absolutely. It's profanity.
Mm-hmm. So what they had done, they had won a victory, but only based on their own standards. I'm saying they did not win a victory over that obscenity based on God's standards.
Right.
Okay? And so who's being the judge? Who's being the judge of what is right behavior? The people, those people, even them, you know, and I understand they had good intentions. But if God sets the standards, they should have been equally troubled by those gossip magazines. Mm-hmm. That's my point. Because if you get 10 people together, I mean, it's easy to see that they have different opinions about what's right and what's wrong, okay?
But that's because people look at sin in degrees.
They do look at sin in degrees.
Mm-hmm.
Quite the contrary to Jesus Christ, who in a Sermon on the Mount said over and over, you have heard it said, but I say to you.
Exactly.
He talks about, you know, you talk about murder, I talk about being angry. You talk about adultery, I'll talk about just looking at a woman with lust. So we need to be thinking. We need to have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
And be judging things or seeing things through the eyes of God, not through our own interpretation of it, right? But that brings it down to, if it's not the community, then the next thing would be the individual.
Yes.
Individuals determine what they think is right or wrong behavior. So now when an individual doesn't have a right relationship with God,
mm-hmm.
that's righteousness.
Yes.
It's based on righteousness. They don't have a right relationship with the Lord, with the King of Kings, with the King of Glory.
Mm-hmm.
They will always be the judge of what right and wrong behavior is.
They'll do what's right in their own eyes.
They'll do what's right in their own eyes, right?
And that didn't go too well.
Well, it never goes well, all right? Anything done outside of
God's
Lord, it's not going to go well.
Well, what happens is you get conflicts between each person.
Well, of course, which is exactly what we have all the time. Right?
No unity.
Well, mm-hmm. there's not. There's no unity. I'm going to talk about in a minute what there is. What there is chaos.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
The unrighteous person will only be subject to the law of the land. That's the community.
Mm-hmm.
To the extent that he happens to agree with them, or to the extent that he believes he can get away and escape the consequence of them, right? Well,
it is possible for a person to live a higher standard than the community.
Are we talking about the speed limit on I-4?
Mm.
Well, it's possible that one person does not do that.
Okay. Wait a minute.
A person could choose to have a higher standard.
No. You don't have a higher standard. There is a standard.
Yes.
It's not like there's a speed limit.
Standard.
If I obey the speed limit, I'm not holding to a higher standard. I am holding to the standard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now I mentioned I-4. If you're not from around here, you may not know it, but pick any major city and pick any highway that goes through it, and look and see how many people are obeying the speed limit. Because if you're not obeying the speed limit, you want to know something? You're disobeying God.
That's right.
Well, what I was thinking is the church as a whole thinks abortion is wrong. You can choose to say that's wrong and not get one.
I have no intention of getting one, but I understand what you're saying. But the point of the matter is, it doesn't matter what you think.
No.
This is what I'm trying to get to. You as an individual, it doesn't matter what you think. Because it's not a vote. It's not put to a vote.
Yeah, that's what God commands.
The Lord God said, choose life. He is a God of life. We don't have the right, and this is what's happening, is that both as the community and as individuals, we are disregarding God's view of things mm-hmm. and coming up with our own standards.
Right.
And we're not allowed to do that. We're simply not allowed to do that. You see, an individual, because he loves self, isn't that what Paul talks about in the last days? Men will be lovers of self.
Yes.
They will always seek what pleases or profits themselves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Regardless of the expense to others.
Or the cost, yeah.
All right? It is clear that the scriptures say that God forms people in their mother's wombs.
Mm-hmm.
John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. God said to Jeremiah, that's what, I knew you, I formed you in your mother's womb.
Yes.
When does life start? If life is about the pumping of blood, because life is in the blood,
mm-hmm.
the heart is formed. That's the first organ that's formed, all right? I mean, I didn't mean to get into a great big anti-abortion discussion, but it's not unprofitable, by the way,
mm-hmm.
because the community, the United States of America as a community and other countries have come to the place where they accept that or they say that is acceptable behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't care what you think. It doesn't matter what you think. And you can all say, well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you think. And I'm telling you, it doesn't matter what I think.
Mm-hmm.
What matters is what God says.
Amen.
That's what matters. That is what is acceptable behavior. And I will just tell you, abortion is not acceptable behavior. Period. Bada bing, bada boom. What I just say, it's about being a lover of self. When you are a lover of self and you determine what is right or wrong in your own eyes, you do it because you're looking for the things that suit you or serve you best.
And make you comfortable.
But will always be at somebody else's expense. If that child being formed in a mother's womb is a life, then when an abortion is committed for convenience, and that's
mm-hmm.
what's happening,
yeah.
it is done at the expense of another life.
Mm-hmm.
And people will answer for that life. Okay? So, if you're doing that, so much there goes the royal law of love. You know what the royal law of love is?
Do unto Jesus. Others as you do unto yourself.
Yeah, that is what it is. Because
as you want done
because,
to you.
And that's not your opinion. It's not my opinion. It is the word of God. James writes in his letter in chapter 2, verse 8, and James says, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. That's what it says. Would it be all right then, a paraphrase of that verse, would it be to say that if you're not loving others as much, or maybe even as more
mm-hmm.
than yourself, you are not doing good.
Right.
The fruit of the Holy Spirit is goodness.
Yes.
Okay? This is very clear. Back in the book of Judges, it talks about the fact that when there was no king in Israel, every man did what was right in his own eyes. If he's doing what's right in his own eyes, every man doing what's right in his own eyes, they have become the arbiter. They have become the determining factor as to what they consider proper or acceptable behavior. Self is a foolish guide indeed. Since the Lord says through the prophet Jeremiah, that all mankind is stupid and devoid of knowledge.
But if a person isn't saved, there's no way they can be good or do goodness.
But see, this is the point. No. See, this is the point. This is why it's not about righteousness. It's about a moral code. Because what you say, you can do good.
Well, you can do good.
The unsaved person that is unique on I-4 actually driving the speed limit is doing good. Whether he knows or not, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
You can do something good. That there's a difference between righteousness and goodness and that bad behavior, all right?
But again, that I was going to say, don't they do the good because it makes them feel good?
Well, no, I'm not going to judge their motives. I'm talking about the behavior. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people, there are unsaved people, mm-hmm. unrighteous people, who don't go around stealing.
Right.
Okay?
They're moral.
Well, that's the difference between morality
right.
and righteousness.
Exactly.
Righteousness is about your relationship with God the Father. And that is only achievable through the atoning work of Jesus Christ. Period. You can't do that yourself. You can't do that. And that's why it says no man is good. There's a difference between being good and doing good. I said this last week. We're not called to be prayerful about what I'm about to say. We're not called to be good.
No.
We're called to be holy. We're called to do good.
Be holy.
And be holy, mm-hmm. right? And we're called to do good in such a way as men see it and glorify God the Father,
yes.
right? Okay. Just listen to this verse in Proverbs 12:15. It says, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but a wise man is he who listens to counsel. A fool always does what's right in his own eyes. That doesn't make it right. Because he is not the standard bearer. He cannot set that on behalf of his own. This is why it says we're not to learn, go back to Jeremiah, it says don't learn the ways of the world. Because the world doesn't know what's good. Solomon's talking about counsel, right? A wise man is he who listens to counsel. The counsel that Solomon is speaking about, I promise you, is clear from the start of his writings in Proverbs. It is God's word that has been given, and this is again from Proverbs, to receive instruction in wise behavior, mm-hmm. righteousness, justice, and equity, right? So that's why it tells us that we're supposed to bring up children in the ways they should go, and they'll not depart from it when they're old. They're supposed to be trained in righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
How do you train somebody in righteousness? Well, the Apostle Paul wrote and said, all scripture is God-breathed and profitable. Profitable for what? For training in righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
So if a child is being deprived of the Word of God, he's not being trained and taught righteous behavior.
Right? Yes.
You wonder why we're having such a problem with people out there? So it's no mistake that the prophet Isaiah, God spoke to the prophet Isaiah and prophesied. This is a great promise back 750 years before the birth of Christ. He said, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonder Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9:6. God is our counselor. He is the one that instructs us. Jesus promised. I think he said, but the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. John 14:26. Well, the Greek word that's used there, as a matter of fact, some translations say the paraclete.
Mm-hmm.
Some translations say the counselor. Right. That's the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Okay? So then, the community and the individual, otherwise known as the world, are not only not reliable judges of what's good, what good behavior is, what moral behavior is, but they actively promote immoral, unrighteous behavior.
Yes.
That's the nature of the being.
Yes.
It is. So
that's the way of the world.
This is why we are warned. This is why we are warned. We are counseled.
Mm-hmm.
Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who substitute darkness for light and light for darkness, who substitute bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter, Isaiah 5:20. And then that's why we're given the command not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, so that we may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. What's the will of God? Well, we talked about this last week. How do you know what's good? Because God told us. He has told us, he has told you, O man, what is good. Anybody know?
Love mercy, do justice, and walk
humbly
with
your
God.
Okay? So it couldn't be otherwise. It couldn't be otherwise. Because we know that we are of God and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. 1 John 5:19. So, in both of those cases that I've talked about, either where the community or the individual determines what constitutes proper or good behavior, the result is ultimately chaos, which is the evil one's playground. Chaos is a void, a separation. I only know of one who can bring order, and God is a God of good order, out of chaos. And the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. Genesis 1, verses 2 and 3. Okay? Mm-hmm. Chaos is confusion, but it's a void. That's literally, by the way, where the word comes from. In the Greek, what it means is a separation, a void, like a chasm, right? Separation from what? From God. Because God is not a God of confusion. I talk about this, and it's not, I'm not being facetious, and I'm not joking. You drive, I-4 is the main highway that goes through the city of Orlando. It goes from Daytona Beach up on the east out to Tampa on the west, right, and goes through Orlando. It is, if you drive through the city of Orlando and see somebody doing the speed limit, you're seeing somebody, it's amazing. I mean, nobody does the speed limit in Orlando. And, you know, Alice and I, we've had to
do a lot of traveling on the road.
And that becomes commonplace.
Yes.
And I said before, what determines morality is, like in England, I mean, we do a lot of traveling on the highways in England. You are much more likely to find people doing the speed limit in England. That's because there are speed cameras everywhere you look.
Right.
So they know they're being watched, right. Okay?
And they do tend to be a little bit more courteous.
Well, yeah, but that's, you know, but the point is, that's what I said before, people behave morally because when they know they're being watched, right. Okay? Yeah. All right? But if you drive through town and you don't know what people are going to be doing, I mean, people are... I made this comment when we were coming up here. You know, we were staying in hotels down south when we came back from overseas, and we'd come up here to meet with Mark and then go up to Deltona for our Sunday fellowship. And you don't know what to expect on the road,
no.
Because I'd be doing the speed limit, and it's dangerous.
Mm.
It's dangerous to do the speed limit because cars are going crossways anyway. Everybody is doing what's right in their own eyes. Now, the community has set a standard. That's called the speed limit.
Right.
And God says, be subject to governing authorities. All right? That's the big community is the government, right?
Yes.
And so they set a standard, and the standard is called the speed limit.
Mm-hmm.
But people, because they are rebellious by nature when you're unsaved, they do whatever they want. The problem is you got cars weaving all over the place, and it is incredibly dangerous.
Yes.
Dangerous because chaos is dangerous.
Yes.
It's confusion. You never know what the guy next to you on either side of you is going to do.
Right.
Okay? And that's why there is accident after accident after accident out there.
Yes, we hear the sirens going all the time.
Yes. But we're supposed to be submissive to governing authorities. Now, that's not because they're so good, because they're not good either. But it's because God has given them a ministry to protect us from evildoers. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So God, then, it's either the standards of good behavior are either set by the community, set by the individual, or they're set by God.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And God is the only one who truly determines the standard of what's good, what's right. Deal with this. Because it says in Isaiah 33:22, for the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. He will save us.
Amen.
So if we're supposed to be submissive to governing authority, that speed limit, you may think, well, it's, you know, it's the city of Orlando that said it. No, no, no. God said it. God gave them the ministry. They've said it. We are responsible to God to keep the speed limit. It's really simple. It really is simple. Jesus, the Word made flesh, who dwelt among us, came first of all to redeem us from the curse of sin.
Yes.
To save us. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
What's the curse of sin?
Death.
For the wages of sin is death. He is also the resurrection and the life, but he is the light that shows the life, right?
Yes.
But he is also the way and the truth, who has come to teach us and show us what a life lived according to the word looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And right up until the very end of his time on earth, right up till the end,
mm-hmm.
it says in Acts chapter 1, verse 2, until the day in which he was taken up. So this is after the crucifixion, after the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is after that, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen. Acts 1, 2. Each person will choose to either listen to the world or listen to the word, to be conformed or to be transformed. The pressure from the world is incredible. It's constant and it is demanding.
Mm-hmm.
But, hallelujah, the word says, you are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world.
Yes.
1 John 4, 4. We live in an increasingly lawless time.
Mm.
That's what Jesus said. When the apostles came to him and said, you know, tell us, what are going to be the signs of the end? What are going to be the signs of your coming? And he said in Matthew 24, verses 12 and 13, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will go cold. But he who endures till the end will be saved. Jesus said that lawlessness would increase.
Yes, and it is.
It's not getting better.
No,
it's getting worse day by day by day.
Mm-hmm.
The United States, we're filming this, by the way, on January 20th, which is the Inauguration Day. We have a different president in the United States right now
today
than we did this morning.
Yes.
All right, there was a transfer of power, okay? But was there? That's the question.
Right.
Okay? God is king over all the kings of the earth.
He is in control.
So when you understand that, there's no transfer of power. He's still the one.
Right.
Well, if you don't like that, then you know what? It's still in the power of the evil one.
Mm-hmm.
And there was no transfer of power.
Right.
Okay? Different players, same game, okay? America is an increasingly lawless nation. And I'm not just talking about murder. I'm talking about anger.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not just talking about adultery. I'm talking about looking at people with lust. Lust, it's incredible, right?
Mm-hmm.
Adultery is something that has gone, like I said, with other sin. It's gone from being prohibited to being promoted. My goodness gracious, right? Just take a drive on the highway, whether you're going through New York or Los Angeles or Orlando or Miami, and see if what I'm telling you is not the truth. Count how many people are speeding. And you wonder how many Christians are speeding out there. If you are breaking the speed limit, you are breaking God's law. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. That's what the Word of God says. The choice you make concerning goodness, good and evil, will determine the words that you hear from Jesus when you come face to face with him. And he says, and then I will declare to him, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evil one, you who practice lawlessness. Or the word I greatly desire that we all hear is, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master.
Hallelujah.
Good and faithful. Because that's where the fruit of the Holy Spirit goes.
Mm-hmm.
From good. And the next one is about being faithful. And that's what we'll do in our next program next week. But until then, Father, we just thank you for this time together. We bless your holy name. God bless you all. Be with us again for our next session. Amen.
Amen. I will play.